we've laid some foundations, we've defined some terms, and if you've not been with us for the first four lessons in this series, you might be a wee bit lost today, but we're going to do our best to get it where you can understand it, be worthwhile your being here. We have finally determined this is going to be a 10-lesson series, so you're halfway there, you're getting there today. Now we need to look at every single passage that is used to prove, put your little finger quotes around that, that God is going to send the majority of people who have ever lived to an eternal, never-ending torture pit of flame. That is what people believe. That is what people have taught. That's what I was taught. That's what I believed. And it has stunted people's ability to look upon God as a God of love. It has killed the spread of Christianity. Because how do you square that circle of saying God is a God of love, and yet 99% are going to be lost forever? So let's take a look at them. We've taken a look at a great deal of other words already with Sheol, and we've taken a look at Tartarus. We've taken a look at these things. But let's take care of the rest of them today. And then next week, we're going to address the question people have. People always bring it up. And that is, are you saying Hitler? And they go from there. We'll talk about him next week, really. And we'll see how the scripture would deal with that type of personality, shall we say. In Matthew chapter 5, in Jesus' first recorded sermon, he said in verse 21 and 22, "You've heard it said that it was said to the people long ago, 'You shall not murder,' and anyone who murders will be subject to judgment. But I tell you, anyone who's angry with a brother or sister will be subject to judgment. Again, anyone who says to a brother or sister, 'Racha,' is answerable to the court. And anyone who says, 'You fool,' will be in danger of the fire of hell." The NIV translates the word hell here, which is a change in the way the NIV normally does. You see, I get this a lot. People will say, Jesus spoke more about hell than any other subject. Actually, no. He spoke about giving and about fearing not more, but I'll let that go. And they'll say he spoke about hell more than he spoke about heaven. No, he spoke about Gehenna more than he spoke about heaven. Gehenna was a different place. We've already mentioned it once, but we will review very quickly here in just a moment. But it becomes very clear that Jesus wants more than just external obedience. He wants an internal changed heart, a changed mind that is reflected in our behavior. And so that's why he doesn't want us to look upon others with judgment, to call them, you're a fool, or you're not worthy of salvation, or you're no longer part of our brotherhood. That's why here, and all of, by the way, down in verses 28 through 30, as well as in a parallel package, passages in Mark and Luke, he warns us against the sins of the heart that will take us to Gehenna. I tell you that anyone that looks at a woman lustfully has already committed adultery with her in his heart. If your right eye causes you to stumble, we know this, it's a really gory bet. It's hyperbole. God has never really said, if you can't stop looking, tear out your eyes. It's hyperbole. And then he says, if you don't, it's better to enter heaven incomplete, without your hands, your feet, your eyes, than it is to enter it whole into Gehenna. So what is going on with Gehenna? Gehenna was a garbage pit. It was not an eternally burning garbage pit. We'll get to that. Remember, we talked about that last week. The words for eternal and everlasting to them did not mean what they mean to us. It meant to them until the purpose is accomplished. To us, we have the concept of trillions, quadrillions, light years, thousands of light years. We have that concept. They did not. And so they used a word that just meant until the age, until it is done. But he's warning the people, and we don't get it because we're not one of these people. Anger can result in being judged by the lower courts. They had a two-tier court system within the Jews, and of course it could be kicked up to the Romans. Contempt. If you go from anger to contempt, you would be judged by the Sanhedrin, or the high court. And hatred would be judged by the entire community. A body was thrown into Gehenna when the community said, this will not be buried here. We will not have any portion of this person in our land. And so they would be thrown into the pit. It was a shame. It was intended to shame the person. And it would shame their family. The power of the community to shame a behavior is often underrated, except by people that know how to use it. Think about this. There's a Facebook page that goes advertisements of the 60s and 70s. And it has one picture that came up, I don't know, a couple years ago, that immediately when I saw it, I knew this is a great picture. I didn't save it because I don't have the copyright to show it. And we're pretty meticulous about that. But it was from a JCPenney catalog, which Americans will remember. And it had a green shag carpet and horrifically orange patterned couches, dark paneling, and faux Tiffany lamps and such. And the caption underneath was, "If you grew up in the 60s, you can smell this room." And I did. Cigarette smoke. Cigarette smoke was everywhere. If you flew on an airplane, they had smoking and non-smoking sections. Yes, plural. Because in first class, you had smoking and non-section, and then you had business class or whatever. Then you had back where I was, where you were lucky to get a seat class. And so there would be a section smoking and a section not smoking. That meant everybody was smoking. By the time you would land in Glasgow or Edinburgh or London, or if you're flying back to New York or the like, you couldn't see the movie because of the smoke. But it's a good thing we're not in this section. You know, that was just, it was everywhere. Why did we stop smoking? It wasn't the commercials. The community started shaming. And the community started going, ah. The community pushed it. And finally pushed them outside into the freezing cold with the lepers. And then, you know, trying to discourage them. And if you go into airports, you can look at the smoker aquarium. If you don't know what I'm talking about, in some airports, they have a glass box where the smokers are allowed to go. And you can, you know, bring your kids to see the wildlife in the smoker aquarium, which is another way of shaming them. Why don't they block that up? No, they want people to look and point. The community shame was Gehenna. You don't want any part of Gehenna. You don't want to end up in Gehenna. This is not a discussion about eternal torment. It's about the shame associated with the sin of hatred. In verses 28 through 30, he warns about using our bodies for sexual or lustful means. That too can result with our bodies being tossed into the garbage pit, where according to the parallel passage in Mark, quote, "the worm does not die and the fire is not quenched." So people will use that and say, see, in hell, the fire is not quenched. He's talking about Gehenna. And that fire is quenched as soon as the thing is burned up. Whatever is tossed there is burned, and that's done. It's a fire that doesn't die out until it does what it was supposed to do. The use of terms back as such as an inextinguishable fire were used frequently at this time in history. Eusebius, or Eusebius, according to how you pronounce his name, said that certain martyrs were burned in inextinguishable fires, even though those fires we know lasted no longer than an hour. In other words, they did not, were not extinguished until they consumed what they were designed to consume. Jesus indicates this in Matthew 26, in a verse right between these, verse 26. "Truly I tell you," talking about you're going to be thrown into the prisons and the like, "you will not get out until you have paid every last penny." In other words, a limited punishment. Not "you will not get out forever," but until you have paid. When the purpose of the punishment ends, the last penny is paid. In Matthew chapter 10, 28, also in Luke 12, 5, Jesus says that very famous saying of, "Do not fear the people that can only kill the body, but those who can kill the body and the soul." Okay? And he even says, "Destroy the body and the soul in Gehenna." Is Jesus threatening us with the loss of our very existence? You can read it that way. You can read it as The gift of God is eternal life. Those people who do not have that gift at death cease to be. That's called annihilationism, that you're just done and gone. And I believe that even though I'm a hopeful universalist, I must leave room for annihilationism in there somewhere, because I also believe in a limited but a real free will to reject God even after death, if one is so foolish as to do that. But here it's possible he's talking about that. Annihilation is a possibility when God's refining fire does not turn the lost to them and they at the end reject him. He may be referring to that, but he might not be. Because a few verses later, in Matthew chapter 10 and verse 39, well, I'll read it instead of just saying it's there. We don't put up scriptures on, but we will. We're going to start trying to do that every so often. The reason we don't is because the sermons are long enough as they are. And also the notes are free and they're in the description box underneath the video. So the thousands of you that watch during the week, you also get free notes that you can use. Matthew chapter 10 and verse 39. Whoever finds their life will lose it. Whoever loses their life for my sake will find it. The word life there is the same word that he uses in verse 28 that's translated soul. This is complicated because people are not always consistent with the way they use their words. But generally speaking, the majority of times, the word soul means life, your breath. God breathed into Adam and he became a living soul. But the spirit is the part of you that lives forever, that has a possibility for eternal life. So in Ecclesiastes, for example, it says, you know, how are we any better than the animals that when we die, our soul goes back into the dust? And there are those that believe that that means that you're just gone. But no, it says your soul, not your spirit, has gone into the dust. You're no longer breathing. Every time I start this and try to use other words for it, I end up getting perilously close to getting to the Monty Python parrot skit, and I don't want to do that. Actually, I do want to do that, but I shouldn't do that. Jesus is saying in the fire of Gehenna, God can bring an end not only to our physical lives, but to our reputations, our goals, our desires, our dreams. And he goes further to explain that God values us too much. And he doesn't want that to happen to us. He says we are worth more, in verse 29, than many sparrows. He's not threatening annihilation, but the ending, he's warning people of the ending of their reputation on earth. Think of this. There were governors in American history, such as Huey Long in Louisiana, that during his life was all powerful. He could do anything he wanted to do and get away with it, and he did. And now nobody wants a statue to him. Nobody wants to be tied to him. In a Scottish village, a man had a beautiful pavement laid out. And after he died, people wanted to re-landscape. And as they tore up the pavement, they found he had robbed tombstones and turned them upside down to make his pavement. His reputation was gone. God doesn't want our reputation at the end to be gone. How many people die and the truth comes out? A man dies and at the funeral somebody else shows up and you find out he had two families. You know, this is just awful. Matthew chapter 23 and verse 15. Another one we know about, but maybe we don't know exactly what it's trying to say. Woe to you, teachers of the law and Pharisees. By the way, this is very familiar to me. This will be done in November in the midweek Bible studies, and those are already recorded. Woe to you, teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrites. You travel over land and sea to win a single convert, and when you've succeeded, you make them twice as child as hell as you are. Can I ask you a question there? How can you go to hell twice? How can you be twice? It's hyperbole. He's making a point. He's not threatening to send somebody to a torture pit, because you can't do that twice as much, but rather warning them that what they teach leads to garbage. It leads to dishonor. The same is true in Matthew 23 and verse 33. You snakes, you broods of vipers, how will you escape being condemned to hell? It was Gehenna. We have other passages for Gehenna. And again, it was well known to the Jews. In James chapter, 3, verse 6, is that right? Yeah, I think so. James 3, 6. And my pages are sticking. Here's a clue. Here's a tip, rather, life hack. Don't use the Bible you also use while eating lunch. Here we are. James chapter 3, verse 6. The tongue is a fire, a world of evil among the parts of the body. It corrupts the whole body. It sets the whole course of one's life on fire and is itself set on fire by hell. Hell was corruption and dishonor. The tongue is not set on fire by a torture pit, but it is set on fire by the place of dishonor. Don't let the place of dishonor be in our hearts. In 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 4, interestingly enough, Peter is quoting a book in his Bible that isn't in ours. And that is the book of Enoch. It was in the Septuagint. It was in the. It's still in the Apocrypha, if you buy a Bible with the Apocrypha. There are several Enochs, by the way, and they're not written by the same person. The first book of Enoch is actually fascinating and quoted a few times in the New Testament. The other ones are, they make Revelation look like Sea Spot Run. They are so convoluted. I do not recommend reading them without medication. 2 Peter chapter 2 and verse 4. For if God did not spare angels when they sinned, but sent them to hell, chaining them in chains of darkness to be held for judgment. He's quoting the book of Enoch. It's rather like quoting C.S. Lewis today, or quoting, you know, Charles Spurgeon today. It's fascinating. By the way, Tartarus is the word used here. And Greek mythology, Tartarus was, if you remember, a prison place in Hades. Hades is where everybody went. Everybody. It's Sheol. It is the grave. And you existed there as shadows, mournful, lost, moving about. You could regenerate and become something new, but only if you're a higher class person. By the way, the only people who taught that were people who considered themselves higher class people, which is very handy. But then there's a prison area for those that were specially bad, and that would be Tartarus. And Peter here uses it in a verb form. Putting them in chains of darkness is the best the NIV can do with it, which is still a whole lot better than the King James, which just uses every word, Sheol, Gehenna, what, and says hell, which throws everybody off. He uses it as a verb. Now, I go down to Louisiana State Penitentiary about every 6 weeks to visit prisoners, and that's next on the schedule in mid-October. It's a prison, infamous prison, and it's called Angola because that's the name of the plantation that they took over and made a prison. It would be like Peter saying he Angola'd them, or he supermaxed them. The angels who did not, when they sinned, were jailed, were supermaxed. But even then, does that prove an eternal torture pit? No. It says to be held for judgment. Even they get a judgment day. Now, what's the point of being in a fiery pit of torture, only to be brought out, to be judged, to be thrown back in? That doesn't seem to make a sense, and we'll talk a lot more about that next week. But just keep that in mind. By the way, we've now looked in these sermons at every single passage and every single word described, used by the Bible to describe what evil is like in the afterlife. We've looked at all of them. We've also looked at the words that we translate eternal and everlasting, and we've shown they didn't mean the same to the people of that day. We illustrated that in detail last week. You would be forgiven for wondering then, where is the justice of God if evil people aren't going to be thrown into the pit? You would be within your rights to ask how we explain those verses, not explain away, but explain those verses by reading in context. By the way, one of the ways we have now 4,670 subscribers, I think, this morning. One of the ways that we've reached out and found new subscribers on other platforms like X and the like are little snippets that John clips and puts out, and little pictures and quotes that Hannah, one of our part-timers at a distance, puts up. Well, because they're snippets, 30 seconds, 45 seconds, they're just snippets. Well, I got a drive-by comment, pretty harsh, used a couple of words, and I wrote back and I said, that would seem to be true unless you look at this, listen to the sermon in context. And it was just fired right back. Oh, in context, that's the get out of jail card for people that don't. And I'm going, okay, let me just help you here. A 5-second Google search does not trump an MD. And Google search doesn't trump somebody who's worked many, many hours and years on a subject. If you want to understand a subject, you have to see the context. For example, I understand the context whenever somebody is singing a Disney song, When You Wish Upon a Star. I understand the context. I don't need to say, are you aware that star might have burned out billions of years ago? And you're wishing upon something which no longer exists. No, I don't need to do that. Sometimes you don't need to say something because you don't know the context, and sometimes you don't need to say something because you do. But context is everything. We have to put everything in context. But anyway, in Genesis 18, verse 25, Abraham, speaking of Sodom, asked, will not the judge of all the earth do right? And he was not asking God to judge Sodom. He was asking God to save them. Will not the judge of this earth do right? And so he and God had a discussion and worked out what doing right would look like. Isn't that amazing? God didn't go, who are you to question me and squash Abraham like a bug? He goes, well, what would that look like? Let's negotiate the terms. I love that. It's amazing. Christians have forgotten this. Let's come, let us reason together, says the Lord. God will do what is right. Yes, God is loving. Yes, God is just. Do justice and love war against each other in God's heart? Do they war in the union? I would say no. But is the traditional view of hell a picture of justice? I would ask you that. Justice demands that the punishment fit the crime. That's why in the Old Testament they had those famous laws, an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth. Now, Gandhi never said, although he's often quoted as saying, an eye for an eye will eventually leave the world blind. No, he didn't. But I get the point. People will say there has to come a time where you stop back and give mercy instead. Do you not understand an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth was mercy? Because in other countries, other laws, if you hit somebody and they lost their eye and they were a person of a certain standing, you would lose your life. You would lose your arm and then your life because they had no antibiotics and no way of fixing the thing. You would die. Instead, God is saying you cannot overpunish anything. You can only go this far. If they struck this, this is struck, or here's the payment. You cannot go farther than that. It was a way to give mercy that I wish we had learned. Because we put people in prison for 50 and 60 years for something they did in 30 seconds, regardless of any change in their life. Queen Victoria, during her reign, and people talk about, ooh, I love the Victorian age. No, you don't. You know you don't. Read some Charles Dickens, and he painted a rosy picture, actually. You could be hung, and they were. 14-year-old boys would be hung for stealing a loaf of bread because their family had no food. That was considered justice. Do you consider that just? I do not consider that just by any stretch of the imagination. To just then endlessly torture for eternity something that somebody did over 70 or 80, I've noticed I get even bigger, or 90 years the older I get, period of time on earth, does that seem just? Well, as soon as you say that, people will say, who are you to question God? I'm not questioning him, but I'm allowed to ask him. I'm allowed to wrestle with God. So are you. And we're allowed to look into these words to see if we got this right. Besides, we follow Christ, who on the cross said, "Forgive them, for they know not what they do." Do you get this? Get your timeline right here. He forgave them before any of them believed and before any of them repented. They were already forgiven because Jesus knows what it's like down here, and he knows we don't get it, even when we should. I know I don't. I know that sometimes at night I'll review the day and I'll go, "Oh no, I completely misread that. I did that completely wrong. I thought I was right, and I thought I was being funny, or like, and I was being a jerk." I get that now. Do I then crawl to God saying, "Don't send me to hell"? No. We're saved. What I do is say, "I'm really sorry. Help me figure out how not to do that tomorrow. And help me, if I can fix things, help me that I can fix things." How about Leviticus chapter 24, verses 15 through 16? "Say to the Israelites, anyone who curses their God will be held responsible. Anyone who blasphemes the name of the Lord will be put to death. The entire assembly must stone them, whether foreigner or native born. When they blaspheme the name, they're put to death." Now, lay aside those that wonder whether God actually gave this law, or let's say he did. What is the punishment for blasphemy? Death. What about the fires and binding? And no, death. There is room for annihilationism, but there's also room for just saying death. Well, I'm not trying to question God. I'm just trying to read his scriptures, and I see he put a limit on punishment. It is right and proper to try to understand what God has said and done and how he defines and who and what he is and what he does. Therefore, we are not questioning God. We're questioning our view of him that has been based upon what we've been taught about some words. Jesus paid the penalty not only for our sins, but for the sins of the whole world. You know that passage? We do. Have we ever considered it? Too many of us think, well, he paid for the sins of the whole world, but most people aren't picking up the gift. Really? He would send his son to go through all of that. He would send the prophets and all the other, just so that you would have to hunt out, if you knew to hunt, the right church. No. Romans 5 and verse 20 indicates that God's grace will not be destroyed by or defeated by Satan's desires or work. That shouldn't surprise us, because Jesus himself said, "The gates of death, of Hades, will not prevail against me." He's going to enter and rob death, even at our worst, when we deserve the worst. He deals with us according, listen carefully, to who he is, not according to who we are or what we have done. And you know how I know that? You should know how I know that, because you heard it from him today in Ezekiel 20, 40 through 44. I'm sorry, 42 through 44. "Then you will know that I am the Lord when I bring you into the land of Israel, the land I'd sworn with uplifted hand to give to your ancestors. There you will remember your conduct and all the actions by which you have defiled yourselves, and you will loathe yourselves for all the evil you have done." Little preview, this is important next week. "You will know that I am the Lord when I deal with you for my name's sake and not according to your evil ways and your corrupt practices." You'll be drawn closer, and as you come closer to God, you will loathe what you've done. You will loathe yourself, but you will also see that I will not treat you according to what you have done, but according to who I am. And who is God? God is love. He said so. Psalm 107. Wait, hang on. Psalms in the Old Testament. Psalm 107. I changed pulpit Bibles. That was a bad move. Well, I had to. Some of the old pages fell out of the other one, and that felt wrong. Psalm 107, verses 10 through 15, some sat in darkness and other chains, prisoners suffering in iron chains, because they rebelled against God's commands and despised the plans of the Most High. So he subjected them to bitter labor. They stumbled. There was no one to help. Then they cried to the Lord in their trouble, and he saved them from their distress. He brought them out of darkness, the utter darkness, and broke away their chains. Let them give thanks to the Lord for his unfailing love and his wonderful deeds for mankind. Look down to verse 17. Some became fools through their rebellious ways and suffered affliction because of their iniquities. They loathed all food. They drew near the gates of death. Then they cried to the Lord in their trouble, and he saved them from their distress. How many times does he have to say it? His love reaches us even when we stand judged and imprisoned in outer darkness because of our sins. Isaiah 4 and verse 4, he will cleanse the cities from their sins. Lamentations 3, 31 through 33. For no one is cast off by the Lord forever. Though he brings grief, he will show compassion. So great is his unfailing love, for he does not willingly bring affliction or grief to anyone. No one is cast off by the Lord forever. How exciting is that? How wonderful is that? Why don't we talk about that? Or Zephaniah. I know you're thinking, Zephaniah again? We read it all the time. But no, Zephaniah 3, verses 8 and 9. Therefore, wait for me, declares the Lord, for the day I will stand up to testify. I have decided to assemble the nations, to gather the kingdoms, and pour out my wrath on them, all my fierce anger. The whole world will be consumed by the fire of my jealous anger. Well, that's it then. They're all gone. Oh, wait. Then, after he's poured out all, the whole world will be consumed by the fire of my jealousy. Then I will purify the lips of the people, that all of them may call on the name of the Lord and serve him shoulder to shoulder. There is hope after death. In fact, Jesus would even, and the scripture would even say there is promise after death. In Malachi, we're told that God's judgment is a refining fire that purifies us. And yes, there is judgment, and we don't want anybody to face that judgment. Yes, there is something dark and terrible and painful waiting for those who have not yet come to Jesus, but it is also merciful and loving because it draws them in. It hit me like a sledgehammer, talking to a prisoner on death row who deserved to be in prison much of his life, but was now in prison for a crime he said he did not commit, and I believe him. But while he was there, he had shown no sign of love in his life, no faith, really, although he said he believed. He was hit and overwhelmed, he said, by the Holy Spirit one day in his cell, to the point where he lost control of himself, and God descended upon him. And I said, what did that feel like? Did he haul up all that you had done and evil? Because this man's life has been changed. For decades, he has done nothing but shown the love of Christ, even in the most horrible place. He said, no. I said, then what did you feel? He said, all I could feel is love. Overwhelming love. And the evil left me because the love couldn't let it stay. It shoved it out. Like the gates of hell, not being able to prevail against Christ. And not that I don't have medical explanations for a lot of these stories, but it is interesting that the stories of people who die and come back, especially the neurosurgeon Eben Alexander, E-B-E-N, Alexander, who by all measurements that we know, and he was being measured for that week or so, he was in a particular stage of coma, which means no thoughts occur. No, nothing. He is neurologically dead. But he came back and he told them two things. He told them things that had happened in the room, things that had happened at a distance and the like. When people ask, how can you know this? He then talked about, he said, I was never really a church person, but I was met with love. And he walks through that process. Now, would I call him a Christian today? No, I don't think so. But here's the thing. I don't get to decide that. The Father of love above does. And I would just like for you to remember Psalm 136. Read that this week. It seems to get boring. I'm going to tell you, short attention span people, tends to get really boring because it'll say a phrase and it says, his love endures forever. Says another phrase, his love endures forever. Keeps going. There are even a couple of songs written like that. Too long songs written about this. But it'll even say, when you were in rebellion, his love endures forever. When you were in Egypt, his love endures forever. It's almost as if he's trying to get something through our thick skulls. And for those of you that are wondering, well, what about Hitler? Why don't you let God worry about him? But we'll talk about him next week. But the thing we need to know now is God is love. And when he said it, he meant it. And therefore, we put our trust in him.